Welcome, Aseem, who I call the Crusading Cardiologist. Aseem needs no introduction from us. There are plenty of YouTube videos. But today we're focusing on Aseem's new book, A Statin-Free Life. And the book covers an awful lot of ground, far more than we're going to cover in one podcast. So I'm going to concentrate on certain very specific aspects. And I tell you, Aseem, the first thing I read right at the foreword, I think it's the first few words of the book, is something along the lines of your genes are not your destiny, or words to that effect. In other words, your genes might load the gun, but it's your lifestyle that fires the gun. And I thought maybe that was as good a place to start as anyone, and let you elaborate on that, and then that'll kind of lead us into the journey of the book.
Absolutely. Thank you, Graham. No, I appreciate that. And that actually, the foreword is written by a very good friend of mine, somebody I admire and respect greatly. He's a cardiologist in Australia called Dr. Ross Walker. And Ross has been sort of on top of this area in terms of cholesterol and statins and the lifestyle management of people with heart disease for a very, very long time. He's got a lot of experience and in some ways has been a mentor to me. So I was really delighted that he wrote the foreword. But to specifically answer that question, it's thought that around up to about 20% of, when it comes to heart disease, and probably related to many chronic diseases, is influenced by your genes, your genetics, and about 80% is environment and lifestyle. And that's what we believe to be true when it comes to heart disease. So that does make sense. It isn't predestined. Of course, some people are at more risk than others. But I think if you do have a family history, then actually, I think it's even more important that you think about how you can best adhere to following the most healthy lifestyle for you, if that's what you want, if you want to have a healthy, long life and not die prematurely from heart disease or have heart attacks. I think that conversation and understanding is very important.
So at the kind of top level, what from your new book, what and it'd be related to the answer you've just given me to your last question, what are the key takeaways that when someone's read the book, we're all going to take our individual things from it, but if you were to lay out what are the most important points that you want to make to the world as a crusading cardiologist, what are they?
Well, I think from the book, the three things I would say, Graham, are one, we shouldn't be overly fearful of cholesterol or so-called high cholesterol. So there's obviously a bit of nuance there, which people will read about in the book, and we can discuss a little bit through the podcast. The second thing is that statins are, the benefits have been grossly exaggerated, even though they're one of the most prescribed drugs in the history of medicine, and the overwhelming majority of people are not going to benefit from them. And the third most important is that this isn't an anti-statin book, but actually what it's promoting is ethical, evidence-based medical practice. And what I mean by that is when it comes to the prescription of statins and when it comes to patients receiving them or being advised to take them, it should be based upon informed consent and understanding what their individual benefit is from the drug, potential harms, and what you do if you get side effects. So I think really the most important, the first two points really lead to the final most important point, is that the book is promoting ethical, evidence-based medicine for the purpose of improving patient outcomes.
Which segues really quite nicely. So it's not often I have a tame cardiologist on the podcast. So I'm going to ask some very specific questions, not least because people will be able to watch many other podcasts with you covering other areas. So I'm kind of picking some specifics. And I thought I'd actually start off with what is a heart attack? Because I think people generally have a sense of what it is, but I wonder how many people really truly are. I mean, you have experienced many of these. So what actually is a heart attack?
So to try and explain it in layman's terms, when I speak to my patients, I always tell them that actually, heart attack is cell death of heart muscle, myocardial cell death, if you like, okay? And that most often occurs in a circumstance where there's been a sudden or a very sudden blockage in one of the blood vessels that supplies the heart muscle with blood. And that blockage needs to last for long enough, and it has to be usually at least a few minutes before damage to the cells of the heart take place. And the gold standard test for that is something called a troponin, That we is a blood test that's carried out usually at least 12 hours after somebody has experienced a potential, you know, a heart attack, to confirm that there's been death of the heart muscle. And of course, you can have a small amount of cell death, a small area of the heart muscle affected, or a very large amount, and that would in some ways correlate with the size of the heart attack.
And on the same basis, what's a stroke? Because I think heart attack, I mean, there's obviously many other forms of cardiovascular disease, but the two killers that everyone dreads are the heart attack and the stroke.
Yeah, I think stroke should be synonymous with a brain attack, if you like. So the very similar process going on in the brain where blood supply is usually cut off. It can sometimes also occur from a bleed, but ultimately a stroke is brain cell death. You know, several cells, if you like, losing their ability to function because of lack of oxygen.
So essentially it's the same process, just playing out in different organs. Is that fair?
It is the same process. The only thing is the risk factors are probably slightly different in the sense of their the hierarchy of what's most important. And I think this, what people, you know, the one thing people need to take away, you know, for the public or patients, is that the single most important risk factor for stroke is high blood pressure. And in fact, that's actually the single most important risk factor for death worldwide, is high blood pressure.
Yep. And we know that we're managing it really badly. I mean, I've done a lot of work in this area, and this is the statistics, at least the latest statistics I'm aware of, Public Health England, you know, that I think 30 to 40% of UK adults have got hypertension.
Yes.
Of whom only 6 in 10 have ever been diagnosed.
Yeah.
But only 2 or 3 in 10 are treated to target. So yeah, although so we're aware of it, the amount of people where we actually successfully treat it is almost third world outcomes. It's vanishingly low, considering how much we're spending on drugs.
Absolutely. On that, Graham, very briefly, I think there are two major issues with the management of blood pressure worldwide, and certainly in this country. The first is that unless you have moderate to severe hypertension, so, you know, normal diagnosis of high blood pressure is your average blood pressure is over 140 over 90, then and moderate is when you get up to 160 over 100. Unless you're in the category of having over 160 over 100, the pills aren't really going to improve your outcomes, and they're not going to prevent a heart attack, stroke, or death. Yet probably most people taking blood pressure pills are taking it for the mild hypertension category. So that's one thing that isn't made transparent to patients. And then you're basically taking a pill which doesn't really have any benefit and opens you up to side effects, which is just crazy if you really think about it. While simultaneously not being managed or advised on specific lifestyle changes that can lower your blood pressure. And then, you know, you reduce your risk and you don't need the pill as well. So it's a complete mess. You know, management of blood pressure is as messy as the management of cholesterol and the use of statins.
No, I completely
agree. I won't use expletives on the podcast, but in my mind, when I look at it and I think about it, expletives come into my mind often, thinking about how we're managing these conditions.
It's absolutely my experience that, you know, a lot of my clients come to me with other concerns, and we take their blood pressure, and their blood pressure is extremely poorly controlled. In some cases, I've ended up with urgent referrals because I know that I can bring their blood pressure down over time. But if they're at immediate risk of a stroke or a heart attack, then we need to do something. But as with everything else, the medical system ignores the root cause, or it blames the wrong thing. So I think we'll come back to that as a theme. Now, I want to talk about cholesterol, because you can't really talk about statins without talking about cholesterol. And I think cholesterol gets a bad rap, and I'll be interested to see what your take is. Cholesterol's kind of an evil thing. Well, I would have a different view of that, and I guess you would. So actually, what is cholesterol? What is the thing we're talking about?
So cholesterol has many roles within the body. And, you know, including the maintaining the integrity of cell membranes, hormone production. It has been linked to heart disease, although the understanding of it is misguided, and really is only very important if your cholesterol levels are very, very high, where it can be seen as a marker of somebody that can develop heart disease prematurely, rather than necessarily being the cause of it, in my view. And it also has a crucial role to play in the immune system, something I discovered in the last few years. And yeah, so without cholesterol, we would die. It's a very important molecule in the body.
And I think that's the fundamental point. You know, 2 million years of evolution, why would that lead us to produce this, that every single cell in the body produces a molecule, a very complex molecule, that's going to kill us? I mean, how does that evolution, either you think evolution is stupid or we're missing a trick here. There is some kind of link between cholesterol. I mean, I think the other important point I always make is there's no such thing as good cholesterol and bad cholesterol. Cholesterol as such is one molecule. Yeah. And I think we conflate the mechanisms that transport the cholesterol, the lipids, and that's where the problems lie with the cholesterol itself.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. So the LDL cholesterol has been given a bad name because it's found within these so-called plaques, these fatty deposits in the arteries that lead to heart attacks and blockages that interfere with the blood flow when people are doing exercise. Actually, it's more likely, a more plausible explanation is that cholesterol is involved. There's damage to the artery for different processes that go on.
Yeah.
And then the cholesterol is there to try and help clear that damage or gets deposited, the LDL cholesterol. So as Malcolm Kendrick, a friend of mine and a GP, he says, just because cholesterol was at the scene of the crime doesn't mean it's the perpetrator.
No, I think
it's like blaming
right.
the fireman for the fire.
Precisely that. I'm a big fan of Kendrick, and he always explains things most beautifully. I'm not sure if this is one of his, but he said, if you were Martian and you're looking at the Earth from outer space, and you see lots of death, and you see all these white vans associated, which we call ambulances, you might conclude that the ambulances are the cause of the problem, but actually they're the solution. And the fact that cholesterol is found at the scene of the crime, just as increasingly there's a view that amyloid plaque, which is kind of the cause of dementia, actually isn't the cause of dementia, it's the brain's natural response to other things that are going on. And by attacking the amyloid plaques in the brain, we're missing the point. Actually, that isn't the root cause. We're tackling a proxy. And I think the whole of medicine is kind of fraught with those kind of errors.
Sure. Absolutely.
So, okay. So there's some kind of relationship, not the one that we have been led to believe, but there is some kind of relationship with cholesterol and the way it's transported and cardiovascular disease. So at this point, how do the statins fit into this kind of picture in your view?
I think first and foremost, the way that I think we need to start from an understanding that 50% of what you learn in medical school will turn out to be outdated or dead wrong within 5 years of your graduation. The trouble is nobody can tell you which halves you have to learn on your own. That was from a quote from Professor David Sackett, who was considered one of the founding fathers of the evidence-based medicine movement. So where have we got to in terms of the evolution of, without going to lots of boring details on where we started, etc. But essentially now it's my own analysis of other people has concluded that really you don't need to start worrying about your cholesterol unless your LDL is certainly greater than 4.9 millimoles per liter, or 189 milligrams per deciliter if you're from the States. That's the units they use over there. And that really is only a very small percentage of people, Graham, that have that level. And then once you get above that level, it doesn't mean you're necessarily going to, have heart disease. There's a strong association there. Most of the people that have that, LDL above 4.9 have something called FH, familial hyperlipidemia, which affects about 1 in 250 people, and genetic condition, you're born with it. But when you go into even detail on those people, about 70% of women and 50% of men will not develop premature heart disease without treatment. And then you look at those people and there isn't any difference in the LDL between the ones that develop heart disease and the ones that don't, and therefore then negates LDL being the cause. There are other things.
So I think that's really important. So, I can't remember again who said it, but there's something along the lines of, if your doctor thinks the problem is the cholesterol, they're 30 years out of date. And I think if the doctor thinks that your LDL is the cause, they're 20 years out of date. And if they think it's VLDL, they're 10 years out of date. And if they know about your trigs, they're in date.
Absolutely. So the next question then is, so now we've realized, okay, there is a marker of potential premature heart disease if it's above 4.9. Yep. Excuse me, but for everybody else, and even those people with an LDL above 4.9, the question is, does lowering it make any difference? Now, unfortunately, because it was thought to be unethical. And I can understand the mindset here. There's never been any sort of randomized controlled trials showing that lowering LDL in people with familial hyperlipidemia actually improves outcomes. This is presumed to be the case because it was accepted that that was the cause of the problem. Yeah. But if you look at all the other data on lowering LDL, and we did a systematic review published in BMJ Evidence-Based Medicine Journal last year, there isn't a clear correlation with lowering LDL and reduction in heart attacks, strokes, and death. So the more you lower the LDL, there isn't a correlation that you have less, you know, risk of heart attack, stroke, or death. And then you look at all the other data which I write about in the book and seeing, is there a correlation with LDL cholesterol, you know, for most people and development of heart disease? And on its own, there isn't. Absolutely. So really, it's much ado about nothing, to be honest. I think you should just see your total cholesterol profile as a marker of your risk of heart disease, dependent on other things like your triglycerides and your HDL. So the most important thing, I think, moving on in terms of the evolution of how we prevent and manage heart disease is looking at your metabolic health markers. And actually, that is synonymous with something called insulin resistance, which is at the root of heart disease and is accepted to be at the root of heart disease. And the five things you look at are whether you're pre-diabetic or type 2 diabetic. You can look at something called the HbA1c, or average glucose level, and it should be less than 5.7, ideally. You look at waist circumference. You know, for Caucasian men, less than 102 centimeters is good. You know, and for women, less than 90 centimeters. And then for South Asians, it should be less than 90 centimeters for men and less than 85 for women. Your blood triglyceride levels should be above, should be less than 1.7 millimoles per liter. And your HDL should be above 1, so-called good cholesterol.
Yeah.
And then finally, you want your blood pressure to be within normal limits. So it should be less than 120 over 80. Once you go above that, you get pre-hypertension. And really, those are the real factors that we need to look at. But we're concentrating, obviously, cholesterol at the moment. And your triglycerides to HDL are really important when you look at your cholesterol profile in predicting even progression of heart disease. LDL doesn't seem to have much of an effect, really, when you look at data and whether it's a predictor of development or progression of heart disease. And that's really what we need to look at now. The reason it doesn't get much of an airing is partly because drug trials that tried to influence HDL and triglycerides didn't really show much benefit. And I think it's because actually the triglyceride and HDL is a surrogate, actually, rather than it being the you know, a causal or related to maybe protecting the heart. I think there's a stronger argument to be made that it is a surrogate marker for insulin resistance. And what you're doing is you target insulin resistance through lifestyle. And actually your cholesterol profile will improve and show, you know, indirectly that your risk has reduced.
Yeah, and exactly right. And it's precisely my experience with my own clients that as we improve their lifestyle, all these metrics improve and blood pressure comes down, their waist comes down, their mood improves, and so on.